Now, without further ado, I would like to welcome Dr. Marianne de Groot-Rovenkamp to host the first keynote lecture in our series Within Teachers as Researchers, which will be on effective teaching approaches for history in primary school. Marianne, I know that she has planned to introduce herself, so I will just tell you that she's being a longstanding friend here at Euroclio. She is now a Euroclio ambassador, and she was president of the Euroclio board for several years. Marianne, the floor is yours, and thank you for being here with us today.
Thank you, Alice, for your nice introduction and for all arrangements you made on beforehand. And I want to, first of all, thank you all for joining online today for this keynote lecture. I really feel very honored to deliver the first lecture in the context of teachers as researchers for Euroclio. And I hope many of you and our other researchers in the Euroclio family will follow this lecture. My lecture will be about effective teaching approaches for history in primary school. But before I start, as Alice said, I want to introduce myself, short introduction. Until recently, I was a teacher trainer for history and pedagogy for initial teacher training for primary school, for history and pedagogy of history. I'm also an author of a widely used textbook for history and the didactics for students in teacher training. And here you see recently published fifth edition of the textbook that I wrote together with Kees van der Kooi. I also contributed to the revision of the canon of the Netherlands, which I'll come back to later. And now I'm a board member of the Canon Foundation in the Netherlands. And here you see the website, which also is in English. I have done research into the understanding of historical time for my PhD, and I also have a website about this research with theoretical and practical implications of my research. Also, great parts of it are translated in English, and currently I'm working as a researcher for the University of Amsterdam, together with Carla van Bokstel, whom you all might know. And we are conducting research into pupils' knowledge and skills for history and geography at the end of primary school. That is grade 8 in the Netherlands. It will be 6th grade in most other countries, children of 12 year old about. And we expect to present our results in the summer of, or the autumn of 2022. And last but not least, as Alicia already told you, I'm ambassador, happy ambassador of Euroclio. Well, the next about 30, 40 minutes, I'm going to talk to you about effective teaching approaches, and the structure of my presentation is, well, a bit two or threefold. I will start with some information about teaching of history and social studies in primary school in the Netherlands, a bit about the curriculum for history education. Then, of course, I will go into the effective teaching approaches. From several approaches, I will tell something about what it is, how it should be carried out according to educational and scientific literature, and what is known from empirical studies about the effects of these approaches in history education. And finally, there will be time for questions. And as Alicia already told you, you can put your questions in the chat. I cannot see them now, but of course, later on, I will be happy to try and answer your questions. About the what of history education in the Netherlands. In the Netherlands, we have core objectives for all subjects. And these objectives have been determined by the government and indicate the core of education for each subject. And these should be reached at the end of primary school. And primary school is includes 8 grades, as I already told you, for pupils aged 4 to 12 years old. For history, there are three core objectives, and they focus on the understanding of historical time and on historical knowledge and skills. The first one is about skills, skills about dealing with simple sources and using the vocabulary of time. And then the other two are about knowledge, and the knowledge concerns knowledge of the characteristics of the 10 eras, and the names of the 10 eras, they are all mentioned in this core objective. They go from prehistoric till modern times, and each era has some characteristics. There are, for each era, there are two characteristics, and they are, for example, about the spread of Christianity in the time of monks and knights, and the multicultural society in the time of television and computer. These 10 eras are symbolized with icons, you see them here. And for the illustration of these characteristic aspects and also of the eras, we have this canon I told you about before, the Dutch canon, which contains 50 historical persons and events of Dutch history, for example, William of Orange, or the construction of the first railway in the Netherlands in the time of citizens and steam engines. So that's a bit about the knowledge of the curriculum. And then they also have to, next to the national history, they also should be able to connect these events and persons of national history with examples from world history, which is the third core objective. We already have these objectives for quite some time, since I think 2005, so more than 15 years. And the whole curriculum, not only for history, but the whole curriculum for primary school and secondary school are, under revision at the moment. It's a large project. I apologize, this is the only slide that is in Dutch, because the website is only in Dutch about this curriculum reform, but the icons about the different domains might speak for themselves. This project is called curriculum.now, which means now, and the proposals for the revision have already been handed in Parliament. They have been presented there, and history is in these proposals part of, well, it's called Men and Society. Well, you should say, could say social studies. And the next step will be the development of new core objectives. But you might know that, we have had elections, and we are now in the stage of the formation of a new government, which will take a while, I suspect. So this has been delayed now. So the whole process of core objectives, before it's been finished, it might be 2023. So until then, we'll have the three objectives from the previous slide. So that's a bit about the what, and then the how history is taught in primary school. Well, the latest research on how history is taught together with geography and science has been conducted by the Dutch Inspectorate in 2014. And in 2014, 80% of the Dutch primary schools worked with separate textbooks for history, geography, science in their lessons. Recently, I conducted a small survey myself in 5 centers of teacher training in the region where I used to work. And from this survey, it showed that in this region, and I think it's rather representative because I talked about it with colleagues in all parts of the country, and they confirmed my findings, that only about 20% has different lessons for history, geography, and the other social studies subjects. And 80%, so it's turned around completely, works with themes or projects. And in my survey, 60% did it with textbooks, so very textbook orientated. And 20% of the teachers responded that they develop these themes or projects themselves. And they also gave arguments why they work with separate subjects or with integrated education. Schools that opt for separate history lessons gave as arguments that they are happy or they find it good that there are clear objectives and learning trajectories, and that these are guaranteed because they use these textbooks where authors have been thinking about the goals and the trajectories through primary school. They also thought it would be more interesting for pupils to have different subjects for history, geography, and science instead of one topic that they worked with for, well, maybe every afternoon or more than 3 hours in the week. These topics and themes could be, for instance, clothing, food, communication, transportation. And they also think that for teachers, it's more convenient to have these separate textbooks with lessons that are completely designed and developed. And they also think for pupils with special needs, it might work better to have clear focus on history or geography or on science. Schools that worked with integrated teams, they did these sometimes because it was more in line with the school concept, like a Montessori school or the inquiry learning theory. They also thought this integrated subjects might be raise more enthusiasm and higher involvement of the pupils. It might be more meaningful for them. And also sometimes they had pedagogical arguments like the development of self-confidence or the stimulating pupils' talents or their 21st century skills. So this is some argument from practice. But when we look into more research in this subject integration, then there in the Netherlands, until recently, there hardly was any research on this theme. But recently, there has been a study of Arie Bilschut and Monique Pels, who investigated the effects of subject integration based on a review of empirical studies. They looked into 77 empirical studies for secondary and primary education. And they found 7 advantages for subject integrations, as these are mentioned in the literature. And from these 7 advantages, 3 can be studied empirical. And the other 4, which are, so the 3 that you can investigate empirically, they are the bold ones. And the other ones seem to me more likely a kind of explanation for these advantages. So Arie and Monique have been looking into these 3 bold advantages, the motivation, the better learning performances, and the opportunities for deeper understanding and critical thinking. From these 77 empirical studies, they have looked if there are really these advantages. By the way, if you look at these advantages in the literature, they are about the same as the ones that were mentioned by schools that made a choice to opt for subject integration. Well, if you look at the studies for these 3 advantages, then, you might be a bit disappointed from the results, because none of the 3 presumed advantages can be adequately empirically substantiated. For more motivation, this seems to be mainly observed in studies with applied mathematics and applied language skills and practical applications in natural science. Those combinations with, for instance, social studies or only history or geography seem to be beneficial. But that's the only combination that seems to be beneficial. And a bit the same goes for the better learning performances. The picture in the studies was a bit varied. There were some studies that mentioned positive but also studies that mentioned negative effects of subject integration on learning performances. And in many cases, the differences between experimental and control groups were really very small. But also here, the effects were the most significant for the integration with language and with mathematics. And then the third one, the deeper understanding or better critical thinking, there's hardly any evidence for this. And Ari and Monique's conclusion was that it might be even, there might even be more opportunities for deeper understanding and development of higher order and critical thinking in lessons for separate subjects, because then you can go deeper into the conceptual structure of a subject. I'm thinking, for instance, historical thinking and reasoning, you can practice it much better in history lessons, I think, than in integrated subjects. So that's the results from research. So now it's time, yeah, more than time, to go to the teaching approaches. In the context of the research project that I mentioned before, into pupils' knowledge and skills in the end of primary school for history and geography, a review study has been carried out in 2020, so last year, and you see the reference below. And in this study, we have been looking for factors that influence pupils' learning performances with regard to geography and history, with regard to knowledge and skills. We looked into 48 studies for history and 42 for geography, international studies. And we found in these studies and also in the educational literature that we have been studying that five teaching approaches are labeled to be effective. And these five approaches you see on this slide, guided inquiry-based learning, environmental education, learning by doing, use of specific teaching materials, and language-orientated learning in subjects. And in the studies, those 80 or 90 studies that I mentioned before, there we found the most empirical evidence for three of these teaching approaches, which you see in bold now. And these approaches had the most empirical evidence of really showing better learning performances. And in the following slides, I will tell something about each of these three teaching approaches, what it is, how it can be done, and what results there are from empirical studies. So starting with the first one, guided inquiry learning. It's a teaching approach that allows students to learn from inner curiosity by observing, questioning, thinking, acting, and reflecting. Usually, students work in small groups on different tasks, like answering historical or geographic questions, processing information, preparing and performing a written or an oral presentation. And very often, textbooks for social studies are based on the assumption that pupils have more ownership in their learning process, and that they can monitor their learning process themselves if they work in this approach. And in practice, you see that very often pupils work independently, search for information on a computer or a tablet, and sometimes also in books. However, it's also mentioned in this review, without solid basic knowledge and skills, this is not successful to let them work purely independently. Pupils start asking questions when they know something about a subject. So they can only search for specific information on a basis of knowledge. So that's why all these studies, and then I come to the how, emphasize that The results of this approach is highly dependent on the guidance that's provided by the teacher. And you see here a few bullet points, what the task of the teacher should consist of, stimulating pupils' curiosity. It's really important, for instance, by a motivating introduction of a theme or a topic with help of variation of teaching materials, which I'll come to at the next approach, to help pupils to stimulate them to create images of the past. And then they can get what Ian Dawson calls a sense of time. By selecting reliable websites, informative books that pupils can use, making very important also a step-by-step planning and giving them a feed-up, which means setting the goals together with pupils, guide them towards these goals during the learning process by giving them feed-forward and also evaluating whether the goals or objectives have been achieved and what can be done better or differently, the feedback. So these, the order I see should be feed up, feed forward, feedback, can help students to, or pupils to become more and more independent in their learning, which means that also in guided inquiry learning, the guidance of the teacher should go down and the independent learning of the pupils, their ownership can increase by doing this. And there are several studies that report on positive effects on learning outcomes. Those are the studies that in which pupils were supported by meaningful questions, step-by-step plans, argumentation schemes on how to process information. So this guidance, guided inquiry learning, it's called, is very important. And an example is a study in the United States of Wissinger and La Paz with pupils between the age of 11 and 14 who weekly examined a historical issue during 3 weeks using some historical sources and background information. And they had to write texts for each issue in which they expressed their opinion based on the provided information. And this study showed that when pupils were supported with argumentation schemes and core questions, they significantly had more historical knowledge about those historical issues than the pupils who did not receive this support. And also the other study, which is mentioned here, showed, well, similar results. And then the support of this second study consisted on a number of clues. So students had a number of clues they had to follow. They had to give in their writing background information. They had to give their opinion with three arguments from the sources. And they had also to indicate what other opinions there were possible. And then they had to evaluate their opinion, they had to ask critical questions, and they had to write a conclusion. So it really was a step-by-step scheme they had to follow in their writing. And also a nice outcome, I think, was that weaker pupils who had reading difficulties, they showed the largest progress in this study on the reading test. So that's really very positive. But there also is a disclaimer. There also have been studies where no effects have been found, so it's not always working. An example is the study you mentioned of Waring and Bentley. It was a very nice one, I think. Pupils had to, 10-year-olds had to make a profile page, like you see on Facebook, but then they had to make a profile page of a historical person based on information from the internet. So they had to provide factual information, but also to add what the person was known about, and include a conversation with a friend. And then, they made these pages, but then finally the results showed that pupils were, although they were really active, very motivated, that the critical handling of sources and historical thinking, especially the contextualization, was only a very low level. So this again shows that guidance of the teacher is really important to get this deeper critical thinking and higher order performances. So much about guided inquiry. Then we come to the specific teaching materials. Well, here you see some examples. And one of them, which I myself have been studying about also, is the timeline, which is very important in history to support pupils in their development of the understanding of historical time. And a large classroom timeline with dates and structures of historical eras, you see an example here, helps pupils to visualize time, and they can add pictures. Sometimes these timelines are also in digital form, where they can drag pictures to the correct era. So this is an example. There are several studies about what is called educative curriculum materials. And these studies show that these materials really can contribute also to the teacher's professional practice and the improvement of the instruction. And of course, this is a reason why it helps to increase performances of pupils. And some design principles that are important, it's not only the material, but to the material, it's important that the teacher has the background knowledge. Background knowledge on subject matter, as well as on the knowledge how pupils develop their learning in a subject, like, for instance, in this case, history. It's what we also call the pedagogical content knowledge that is important for how to use the materials. And for teachers, it's also important for when they have these instructional materials, for instance, a timeline, that they have suggestions for how to adapt materials for pupils with different educational needs. And the materials should also be able to use them, that they can really stimulate students' learning. So it's a few design principles that are important in the use of these materials. And I have an example from my own textbook. It's called, for Dutch speaking audience, Beeldvorming Schema. I translated it with Image Building Scheme. It's what I said before, it's important that pupils get an image from the past, how people lived, how they worked, how they communicated. And this image is important to get a sense of time. And you can use different materials to support pupils in their development of this image building. And this is a scheme that starts from reality and goes to doing. It starts with the tangible, concrete image builders to more the imaginary image builders. And that's based on the developmental psychology of Bruner and Galperin, who describe different learning actions or representations that also go from very concrete to more abstract. And with the help of such a scheme, with the backgrounds and examples that we described in our book, teachers can make a very conscious choice for use of specific materials with appropriate teaching methods and learning activities. And that's, of course, important for the development of historical consciousness, historical thinking, and that pupils can build these images, how people lived in a specific era, what experiences they had or made. And also from research, also from my own research, it came out that especially stories and images are very strong, effective image builders, also for very young children. So that's an example. I could talk longer about this, but we go to some results of various studies in the Netherlands and also in England have shown that the use of specific teaching materials is not optimal. So teachers could do more in this context. In this survey of the inspectorate that I mentioned before in 2014, it appeared that when it comes to the teaching of social studies, that in a quarter of the lessons, teachers do not use any tools, no timelines, no maps, no images, no stories. And that is a pity, because there are quite a few studies in the context of primary school that show positive effects for example, use of timelines on pupils' historical knowledge, and especially the knowledge of the time vocabulary, knowledge of chronology, knowledge of characteristic aspects of historical eras. It really is helpful to use a tool like a timeline. And also in my own research, it came out that most teachers do not use a timeline, and that's really a pity. When it comes to effects, well, then I use my own study as an example. About 800 pupils in grade 4 and grade 7 worked for 5 months with an approach called TimeWise, which was an approach in which pupils constantly had to make connections between historical events and the timeline while using stories, pictures, and videos. And the outcomes of this study, well, you can see it on this slide, that after 5 months, the pupils in the experimental condition scored significantly higher on the test on the understanding of historical time. And that's really, because of the use of this timeline, the stories, the pictures, the videos, that they got this image of the past and a sense of time, and also could use the vocabulary on dates and all that comes to that. Then I come to the last, where's my watch? I have to keep time myself. the last approach is about using language when you are learning about a subject like history or geography. And that's something that we also looked into. And in our review study, we saw that it's important that objectives of history or geography go hand in hand with the learning of language skills like reading and writing. And it's important that teachers create a rich context in which pupils can use their language, opportunities for interaction, and also the teacher should give language support. I'll come back to that in the next slide. And when you do that, you have a win-win situation for learning the language, but also for learning history or geography or science, let's say social studies. There is a book, but it is in Dutch. It is called Language Should Be Used in All Subjects. And then it's also always the focus in this learning, using language learning in subject learning, is the development of concepts. The learning of historical concepts is, of course, is a very essential part of the learning of history. And for very young children, it's about very concrete concepts that relate to daily life, and also historical eras that really appeal to their imagination, like, for instance, about knights and castles in the Middle Ages. And as children grow older, concepts can be expanded further to more abstract concepts and higher order concepts, such as Renaissance or Industrial Revolution. The problem is that historical and geographical concepts often have a high degree of cognitive complexity. For instance, feudal society, privileges, regions, and also historic concepts that seem to be easier while they're used in everyday life, like trade, traffic, agriculture, can also be difficult because they looked very different in another era, in the Middle Ages, for instance, or in prehistorical time. like you can say, the past is a strange country. They do things differently there, like G.P. Hartley said in his novel. So this cognitive complexity is difficult, and also the context of the past is difficult. So what should teachers do when teaching about a language in subject? They should try to diminish this cognitive complexity by providing prior knowledge in a language lesson before you go to the history lesson. And on the other hand, increase the contextual embedding, for instance, through the use of concrete materials such as pictures and photos. And of course, you can use this image building scheme to enlarge this contextual embedding. And you could do this in a three-stage model, in which the first stage is a context with experiences and context in which teachers can use the difficult words that can be selected, or concepts of words that can be selected in advance. And then these difficult words are used as much as possible with a lot of visual material to make them concrete. And when you do that in a first lesson, which centers around the language of the concepts, you can work with a text from a history textbook or a social study textbook in which these words appear. And then you could have a next stage where pupils can apply those newly learned concepts in a new history context. And that's the model that is, proposed in this book about language learning combined with history or social studies learning. And in that way, a teacher always is a language teacher. So not only during language lessons, but during all lessons, teachers can stimulate pupils' language development by providing the proper input, by offering a lot of space and for pupils to use the language, but also subject space, so that the language that belongs to a subject can be used in different situations. And finally, of course, this feedback is very helpful. How can pupils improve their language in a subject, help them clarify difficult concepts, and also, most importantly, I think, is confirm and when students use the language in a correct way. That's a bit in this diagram on this slide. So it's important for teachers that you're always aware of these principles when teaching history or geography in primary school, to make this link with language, because that's really also proven in the previous study that I mentioned about subject integration and effects as something that works very well. About results, well, I already told you something about results, because in the previously discussed studies on guided inquiry learning, it was also about how geography and history can be linked to reading and writing. And I know in the United States, it has become more and more common to make this integration, because they have this No Child Left Behind Act. And that's what I said, especially for weaker pupils, this really works very well. So they really strongly interact the objectives of social studies to objectives for literacy. So also in the studies that I mentioned before, pupils really improved their reading of historical text if they practice with these step-by-step plans and schemes to extract information from sources, and that they can make better historical arguments when they practice with an argumentation scheme. And often these studies follow the model of cognitive apprenticeship, in which teachers explain and demonstrate a particular approach, and then pupils try it themselves in smaller groups together with their peers, and later also individually, and it can be repeated several times. So I'm looking at time, because I see I'm the 40 minutes, I'm already there. So I'm going to finish each approach I've told some a bit about. I have some references. I will see that you can get my PowerPoint if you might be interested. And it leaves me with the last one. Thank you for your attention and a reference to my website and the email address that goes to the website where I can be reached for questions that might not come to your mind now, but I hope there are some questions in the chat.